A key source of support for President Trump comes from the white evangelical community of Christians. Reverend Robert Schenck is a clergyman from that very group. And after some deep self-reflection, he changed his mind on some of the so-called culture war issues and regrets his often divisive rhetoric at the time. He now leads an educational nonprofit which takes inspiration from the anti-Nazi dissident Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was executed for plotting against Hitler. Here he is now talking to our Michelle Martin about embracing empathy in these turbulent times.
You, along with Pat Robertson, are one of the very few white evangelicals to criticize the president for this at a time when there's obviously great unhappiness, anxiety, and grief in the country. Why do you think that is?
I think first it points to the moral collapse in my own religious community. Among my fellows, there was a Faustian deal made with Donald Trump, which went something like this. Donald Trump promised, I will give you everything you've ever wanted on your laundry list of political deliverables if you give me what I want and demand, and that is religious cover. I need you to say that I'm blessed of God and that everything I've done is good. He defended the photo in front of St. John's Church with the Bible by saying a lot of Christians think it's a great photo. And that's what he needs in the deal. And we made that deal with him. And so there's a moral vacuum. There's an inability to muster the moral courage to stand up to this. I was delighted to see what Pat Robertson said. The fact that he did speak out was terribly important, though a little late in the game, but he did. But my other colleagues have not been able to do that for a number of reasons. One is because they would be assailed by their own constituents now for doing so. But the other is they would lose access, instant access. They know that Donald Trump will throw them under the bus, will lock them out of the White House, will insult them and disown them in an instant if they displease him. They are aware of that. And so they have to play this game very, very carefully. They're on very thin ice. They want what they still have outstanding on the list, which is a final appointment to the Supreme Court to give them a rock solid conservative majority. They're not going to let anything endanger that, even this kind of supremely offensive behavior.
We keep hearing, particularly from political figures, that privately the conversations are different. I don't know how much credence to give to that, because the fact of the matter is, if you are a public figure, your public utterances are your record. But I do wonder what kinds of conversations that you have with fellow evangelicals, because quite in public, the support is as strong as ever. I mean, you know, Ralph Reed, who's kind of taken over the mantle of the moral majority, as it were, sort of the politically most active evangelicals, particularly white evangelicals, social conservatives, you know, very strongly defending it. I was just sort of curious about that. Their support has been as strong publicly as ever. Are the conversations privately different?
Well, you know, a year, 2 years ago, I used to hear my colleagues, they would whisper, you know the guy's way over the top. I know he's terribly offensive. I know he's way too visceral. He's too impulsive. He doesn't know us. He's not religious. Look, we know who he is. He's a secularist. He's not a believer. But he's good for us. And who else is going to get this done? And it's going to take a fighter like him to get it done. Now I don't hear that much anymore. And that's even more distressing to me, because what it seems to suggest is that a kind of final conversion has taken place, at least in their thinking, if not in their hearts. And if it is in their hearts, then I fear for them. I mean, in one sense, just in terms of reclaiming their moral integrity, regaining a sense of ethics, and what is right and wrong. And if they have lost that ability to discern that, then they are indeed in very grave danger personally, certainly as a community. I mean, we know what the history of demoralized churches are. They quickly become relics of history and not good ones. And then, of course, I'm still a believer in salvation. I think we have to have a certain standing before God. And if we lose that, we've lost everything. The Bible even reminds us of that. It says, what does it profit a man if he gain the whole world but lose his soul? That's the ultimate loss.
I do know that the Southern Baptist Convention just had their convention. It is the nation's largest Protestant denomination, and they show a membership decline. It's the 13th straight year of decline. It's the largest single year decline in more than a century. What are you seeing?
And that's true almost across the board, and especially when you look at under age 45. And the younger, the worse the statistics become. Young people especially are leaving evangelical churches in droves. And why? Because they see the hypocrisy. They see an identification with establishment power, with political force and influence. They are tired of the combat, the social conflict, the wars, many of them ginned up. Look, I know this stuff personally. I battled with fundraisers for decades who told me, look, we need to leave your people afraid and angry. Mm-hmm. The madder they are, the more fearful they are, the more money they're going to send you. Give us more fear and more anger. I was actually told that explicitly at a conference room table. We need more fear and more anger. Well, young people are sick of that.
You've had some significant breaks with others in the evangelical movement over the years now. I mean, you've broken with them on the issue of expansive gun rights. You've broken with them around the issue of how abortion should be discussed and thought of, sort of a number of issues. And I can imagine that, you know, some people would say, you're the wrong one. I mean, you're the outlier. You're the one who's getting it wrong. And in fact, some people might argue that your point of view is dangerous, that you're imperiling people's souls. And I just wondered how you have reconciled yourself to this, you know, over the years. What convinces you and affirms you in your view that your path here is the path that really others should be taking, humbly, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's been anything but easy, including internally. It's been a very difficult journey for me, but it started by facing myself, and that was a terrifying thing to do, to listen to my own words and to watch their effect on other people, on the other person, instead of constantly listening so that I would feel better about myself. I started listening to hear the effect of my words on others. That was part of that process of change. But I'm not alone. There's a book out now called The Spiritual Danger of Donald Trump, in which 30 top level, some of the best evangelical hearts and minds in the United States, writing essays, warning of why the Trump culture, not necessarily Donald Trump as an individual human being, but the political and social culture that Donald Trump represents and fosters, is so dangerous, particularly to Christians. And I go back to, again, what is our message? What are we trying to proclaim and live out? And if I look at the model of Jesus, and if evangelicalism is anything, it's Jesus-centered. We call it, in theological speak, being Christocentric, Jesus Christ being at the center of everything we say, do, believe, proclaim, practice, all of it. The centrality is Jesus Christ. He becomes the model. Too many Christians segregate the world. We are segregationists. into the saved and the lost, those who know God, those mm-hmm. who don't, those who are sinners, those who are saved and sanctified. Well, that's not the way Jesus treated people. He treated every human being with precisely the same love, respect, and dignity. And that's the heart of the gospel. So for me, this is all about returning to my original faith, not renouncing my faith.